Money Smart Guy, Matt Cipolla here, hailing to you from San Antonio, the free enterprise world. And I'm here, the world's toughest man, David Goggins. What's going on, brother?
Not much, man. That's what they say.
Humble, but intense.
Right. I gotta stay after it, man.
Baby, you just rocked our stage. We have 1,500 people here. Our CEO just sent me a text. You're the most appropriate speaker they could have chosen for this, because we have a lot of new aspiring entrepreneurs here.
Right.
And I want to touch on that real quick, because I want to know about your journey leaving, retiring from the military. You retired as a chief, right?
Right.
Yeah, chief petty officer.
Yes, sir.
So you retired as a chief. What was your transition like out of the full-time military? What were you doing?
You know what, it was tough for me. So I got in the military after 21 years. I retired in November 2015. I went right into being a wildland firefighter.
So naturally.
Naturally, you know, yeah. let's find some more grunt work.
Yeah.
And let's get back after it again. Right now, I'm in that, you have to evolve. And that's the hardest part for me right now is I've always been a knuckle dragger. And I'm always gonna be a knuckle dragger. But in life, if you're not evolving and you're not trying to recreate yourself, you're not getting any better.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, you know, being a Navy SEAL, going to Ranger School, all those things I did, they were all get after type of stuff. And my mind is driven towards that. But I'm believing the thing, that's my comfort zone, I believe. So now it's all about me coming outside of that. So now what I'm doing is, I'm very uncomfortable on stage. I'm very uncomfortable right now. I'm an introvert,
big time
introvert. So I used to stutter growing up.
Mm.
So being in front of people, being on camera, all these things right now are big growths for me. But what I realized though, is I'm changing lives by being raw about how messed up I was. So kind of getting out of the military, what I'm doing now is trying to find my niche in the world and like, okay, what can I do? And my story is affecting a lot of people. So I'm going around spreading my story to a lot of people right now.
And one thing that how you were discovered, really, Living with the SEAL, mm-hmm. the author of the book, Living with the SEAL, you're running a 100-mile type race, raising money for the special operations community.
Right.
How did you know how to do that? I mean, some guys, how do I contribute back to our veteran community? How did you go about organizing that? Did you just look for sponsors, sign up for this race, you know, donate to my cause? How did you go about doing that?
It was crazy how it happened. I was at, so there's a story called Lone Survivor.
Yes.
It's about Marcus Luttrell.
Yeah.
I was in Navy SEAL training with Marcus Luttrell. And I also was in training with his twin brother, Morgan Luttrell. So Morgan's his twin. So during the incident, me and Morgan were at military free fall school.
Hmm.
Where you jump out of an airplane, 12,500 feet, you fall for a minute, you deploy your parachute. We were out there during our last jump. During our last jump, Marcus was in the worst incident in Afghanistan in SEAL history at that time. We got to the ground, I got a text message that I'm supposed to be telling Morgan Luttrell that they think Marcus is dead.
Hmm.
Marcus wasn't dead, but no one knows this right now.
Yeah.
So I'm telling Morgan or Marcus about what's going on. Morgan looks at me and Morgan says, he's not dead. I said, well, everybody else is dead, man, and they can't find your brother. 4 days later, I get a call from Morgan saying they found his brother.
Yeah.
That story touched me, man. It was freaking to me, it touched me.
Like the twin connection, right?
Yeah, right, that's what it was. And all the guys in the operation, I knew them all, because I was in Buzz for so long. So I knew them all, I was about 250 pounds. I was not a runner at all. So I'm like, okay, most of these guys had kids. So I went and found a foundation that gave 100% tuition for special operators who have died during training or died during the war. If you have a kid, this foundation, Special Operations Warrior Foundation, will send your kid to college, 100% tuition. And I was like, this is great. So I found a foundation. Then, me being the knuckle dragger I am, I Googled the 10 hardest races in the world. And trust me, I only ran about 20 miles this whole year. This is in November now. So about 20 miles a whole year, and my workout routine was go to the gym, and my cardio was 20 minutes on the elliptical every Sunday.
That's it.
That's it. So what comes up on this Google search was, number one was Badwater 135. 135-mile run through Death Valley in the summertime. So I found the race, but I think the race is just a stage race. A stage race being like you run 15, 20 miles, set up a tent, barbecue out, and then run some more. I didn't know it was a 48-hour race where you run 135 miles. Didn't know anything about that. Called the race director up. The race director said, you got to qualify for my race. I go, how do you qualify? He said, you have to run 100 miles in 24 hours or less. I called Sky up on a Wednesday. The next race I could do to qualify was Saturday. So I had like three, four days. And I'm like, in this race. So it's a long story short, man. It's a horrible race for me, all over the place. My body's breaking down, my mind's breaking down, physically, mentally going through the hardest challenge of my life. I get through it and I get in the race. That's kind of how the whole thing started.
That's crazy. So by doing something good, you discovered the next best version of you.
Right, I discovered this right here. I discovered my 40% rule.
It's interesting that as I'm listening to you and reading your books, I'm listening to you talk, it's almost like you're always testing yourself.
Right.
And then you have this perspective like, yo, this is what I just did.
Right.
And you're always in that self-discovery mode. Oh, wow, this is a limit.
Right.
I can push myself to that limit. How can somebody's watching this, how can people break through those limitations and barriers?
It's very hard to do it, man, because you have this internal conversation going on. And you know what? The most important conversation you ever have is the one you have with yourself. And we have this dialogue going back and forth. We have like these two people in our head saying, do it, don't do it, this is stupid, I'm not good enough. So basically, like the best way to do it is you have to first overcome fear. The fear of failure, the fear of being judged, the fear of not having the courage to accomplish what you want to do. Yeah. So that's the first thing you have to do. And also, it might take you 20 times of putting your toe in the water and say, I'm not ready yet. That's okay.
Yeah.
But you got to put your toe back in the water. Pretty soon you put it up to your knee. Then up to your waist.
Yep.
Then pretty soon you realize, you know what, this isn't that bad.
Yep.
So it's fear of the unknown. But once you become a master of what you fear, then you can start really breaking it down and finding self-discovery throughout all these journeys that I've been on.
You know, I was talking to your fellow SEAL, you know, Jocko, and I asked him about PTSD, okay? And so one of his ways of dealing with PTSD is, listen, about the stuff we've been through, that's not gets gone.
Right.
But I'm finding my next mission.
Right.
Somebody's dealing with PTSD right now, they're watching this video. How would you help encourage them to deal with their situation?
Well, I got diagnosed with PTSD. So I retired 21 years and I didn't see anybody for it.
Hmm.
So as I'm getting out, they're like, hey, you should really see somebody for PTSD, see where your mind's at. Before I even got to my military career,
you were going through.
The lady was like, no, we can't even give you combat PTSD because your childhood and what you endured as a kid, you had PTSD then. So it wasn't like I could get PTSD as a child and growing up and then now in the military. So PTSD is something that I've lived with my entire life. It's something that they think you get over, and you might. I really didn't get over it, but how I deal with it is recognizing that, to talk about it. I have to have trusted people.
That.
Yeah, heal through it. So what I used to do is I used to recluse because I'm already an introvert.
Sure.
So this be hard, be tough, don't talk about it. I'm not saying talk to everybody, but my fiance, I trust her, I trust my mom, I trust a select group of people, and I have to get stuff off my chest. But you also have to find the right people who are willing to listen. In this day and age, you're telling somebody that's, you know, something that's deep and meaningful to you that you know, that's hurt you. And people aren't listening to you. And they're like on their phone, like, and you see that.
Yeah.
So that causes more PTSD, like, oh my God, no one cares about me. So you gotta find things, people that care about you, truly care about you. Also, you gotta care about yourself. There comes a point in your life where it's serious, PTSD is serious. But you also gotta stop feeling sorry for yourself. There's a point, and I say stop feeling sorry for yourself very gingerly, because I'm not putting that down at all.
Yeah.
So don't take that wrong. There has to become a time in yourself where you say, you know what, I can handle this. What I've been through, a lot of people have been through, and I'm strong enough to deal with this.
Yeah.
And that's when you start to, you know, get back in the gym, get back finding goals, get back trying to discover yourself again, reinvent yourself outside of the PTSD. That it can't own you.
Right.
It can't own you. So you're always on self-discovery.
Can't own me, can't hurt me.
That's it. Can't hurt me, man.
So I was talking to Jennifer out there, and we were talking about your book too as well, which is kind of an interesting story because you wanted to self-publish your book. You got offers, but you self-published because you wanted to own your story. I went through that mistake too. I was attempting to write a book. I didn't like the way it's coming out. Oh, we got a deadline, man. And like, dude, I don't want to, my name's on that thing. It's my story.
That's
we got a deadline. And I'm like, well, how do you not do it? Well, you got to buy your rights back.
That's right.
Like, I got to buy my own story.
That's
back.
Right.
So I went through that mistake. So a lot of guys that watch my YouTube channel are veterans and also entrepreneurs. What one bit of advice is, you've been down this road of entrepreneurship, you know, building this new brand of David Goggins.
Right.
What bit of advice would you give to a veteran considering entrepreneurship, and why should they?
The biggest thing I'm going to say right now, a lot of people, I didn't have a lot of money. So you kind of, business out here is corrupt. no matter how you look at it, people are trying to make a dollar. Period.
Yep.
Period. So you can end up selling your soul for a quick buck. Mm-hmm. That's not how you want to do it. It's always the long game.
Yeah, there you go.
If you have to suffer, if you have to suffer for a short period of time, that's fine. Suffer. Eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Eat suck it up sandwiches. Drink a can of hard. Whatever you gotta do, stay in it. Because the long game is the payoff. And what that means is, I got offered $300,000 for the short game.
Wow.
Just first time author.
Which sounds like there's over a quarter million.
Military, you know what it is. You don't make any money. So literally, that's like 5 to 6 years of my salary in one check.
Yep.
My life was hard. I endured a lot. My story is powerful. The short game was take $300,000, give them 85% of what I'm going to make, and I get 15%. Doesn't make much sense to me.
They get 85%.
But everybody tells me, that's just how it goes.
Yeah.
That's what you always hear in business.
Yeah.
That's how it goes. That's how Audible does it. That's how they do it. That's how the publishing house. It's just how it goes. People accept that kind of bullshit. That's how it goes.
Right.
Don't accept that. Don't accept it. It's not how it goes. How it goes for me is I'm going to self-publish. I'm going to take a chance on myself. And by doing that, it was the best move I ever made in my life. The best move I made in my life was not trusting what people say. So have confidence in yourself. Don't go with the short game. Go with the long-term goal. Like, look, I want to be here 10 years from now. Don't be like, I want to be here tomorrow. We have no patience in this world. Develop patience.
David, when you're looking at your brand, you're looking at your whole model, not where you're going. You know, I think the interesting thing about your message is that I lost 100 pounds in 3 months. What's this big significant difference that you experienced through Air Force PJ, through Army Rangers, and obviously yourself?
What's a change in my mindset? When I first went to try to become an Air Force pararescueman, I had tackled a lot of the surface problems I was dealing with. The second something got extremely hard in Air Force pararescue training, I didn't mentally know how to handle it. I thought I was dealing with stuff. You know, I taught myself how to read pretty much. I then taught myself how to swim. I thought I was dealing with problems. So the biggest change for me was I went down to the root cause of why I became a quitter, why I had the quitting mind. I was like, okay, man, something's not working here, man. Something's not working. So I went to the root cause of it. The root cause of it was my childhood. I had to go back to where it started at, which was my father.
You reconciled that.
That's right. I had to go through and fix all that. You know, I went through, fixed it all, went down, rebuilt my foundation. And then when I was making that move from a 297-pound man to 191-pound man, losing weight real fast and going to try to be a Navy SEAL, no longer did I have the quitting mind. So when when I got set back and still training 3 times, I didn't care. My new norm was I'm not leaving.
Until you become a SEAL.
Until I become a SEAL. Versus I'm not good enough, I'm gonna leave. So that was the thing about my mindset. I went back to the roots, the root cause of the problem, fixed my mindset, gained the tools necessary to stay in the war until I won it.
The mantra, okay, because I'm talking about veteran entrepreneurs, leaving the military, owning your story, what you went through, and becoming an entrepreneur.
Right.
You know, one of the things I was really frowning upon was how the media was talking about other Navy SEALs. Well, you know, they're selling their story and doing this. They're selling the Trident.
Right.
All that crap, right?
Right.
That's what you went through.
That's right.
And so what advice? Because when I was getting out of the Marine Corps, Ace and Paul, you don't know anything else besides being a Marine.
Right.
Stay in the Marine Corps. We'll see you in 30 days.
Right.
You're going to come back in anyway.
Right.
All you know how to do is be a Marine.
Right. True story.
And so what advice would you give to a veteran out there that says, you know what, even your brothers and sisters, right? Your veteran community, military community is going opposite against you. The media is selling the Trident. How would you address?
You know what? I have a great answer for that. My book, even though I'm wearing the uniform and you can see the Trident on there, Trident's kind of covered up. You see David Goggins.
Yep.
You don't see Navy SEAL.
Right.
You don't see that.
Yeah.
This book isn't about me being a Navy SEAL. Become bigger than the military.
Yeah.
Have more of a story than just the military. A lot of people who are selling the Navy SEAL story, the Navy SEALs are getting mad for a reason. I mean, I don't see why. Yeah. Stop caring so much. The Navy SEALs did not make you who you are. People think because you now wear a Trident, the Navy SEALs made you. No, you have to get through buds, okay? So if you don't walk into buds, first day of buds, SEAL training, ready to kick ass, you're not gonna make it. So how I look at it is the men that graduate SEAL training make the trident.
There you go.
The trident does not make the men. We have to get through it. If you can't get through the training, you don't earn the trident.
Yeah.
That trident is just a piece of metal.
Yeah.
This is what goes through SEAL training, a human being. So those guys who have a hard on about that, they're just mad because they're not the ones doing it. But I'm not selling that story. I'm not selling a SEAL story. It so happens I went through Navy SEAL training. It's a very small portion of my story.
It has no OPSEC stuff in there.
No, yeah. My story is about overcoming yourself.
Yeah.
I happened to go through BUDS 3 times, that's in there. Also went through Ranger School, also went through TAC-P, Pararescue, Delta Force Selection twice.
Wow.
I also broke Guinness Book of World Records for pull-ups. I ran 205 miles. I did a whole mess of things, had 2 heart surgeries. It's a story about overcoming oneself. So what, be bigger, do more than just the military.
I love it. Well, listen, you got David Goggins here. Make sure you follow him on Instagram. And I appreciate you guys, for those of you who are watching this. If you got questions, you got comments, you got feedback, I'd love to know about it. Drop it in the comments section below. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe. And also you hit notifications to be alerted the next time we upload the next episode. If you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like to like our business page. Listen, this is your Mighty Smart Guy and the veteran entrepreneur. Get some serious. If you like this, please share it. On behalf of David Goggins, I'm your Mighty Smart Guy. Till we meet again. Continue to live smart, continue to love smart, and be money smart today.
All right, ready?